Okay, so I start with my series of lectures. So I will speak on the analytic theory of GL2 automorphic forms. And so there are many different ways on how to give this course. So since this summer school is, I assume, is mainly for classical analytic number theorists, so what I want to do in this course is to present the analytic theory of modular forms, but in the Adelic language. And okay, so the Adelic language is really a language. But it's in several situations, it is a device which is very powerful. So the point is that in the beginning, it may be a little bit forbidding if you are used just to work with classical spaces. But in some situations, there is a great reward in investing some time in understanding the basics. So really, in many cases, it's just a different way of, you can see it as a way of reshuffling the order of the argument that you are used to use. Many devices which are presented in the Adelic language are imported technologies from the classical setting. Nevertheless, it allows, again in some cases, treatment which is very uniform. So that's why I want to make some emphasis on this, because I think it should be part of the natural background of an analytic number theorist. So I do this for GL2. Okay, GL1 is very interesting, but so GL2 is contains it, and because GL2 is not abelian, it's both relatively rich with interesting phenomena and also relatively simple. So, so when giving this kind of course, I cannot, so it's impossible for me to start by just defining the adels, the idels, and just running the theory. I think it's necessary to start with an interesting, motivating example on why the Adelic language is really can be useful. So I will start with an example or a very classical problem which I will begin to treat adelically, and so I hope I will not spend too much time on this, but it may take some time, and probably in the last lectures, it's where we will start to do real analytic number theory over the adels. So, but so the The example I want to discuss is so Duke's, so it's my favorite example, or one of my favorite examples. So Duke's theorem on so representations of integers by ternary forms, quadratic forms, sorry, quadratic, yes, ternary quadratic forms, and yeah, and this is really a problem, so which is completely solved, for which there is a big advantage in working at Delicali, because then it's easy just to prove the theorem, so Duke's theorem even over number fields, and the proof is not more difficult than say over the rational. So, but I will do it over the rational here. But so we'll just start. So I just take a quadratic space. So n here will be say greater than 3. Qn non-degenerate quadratic space. And so I assume that the quadratic form Q is integral, by which I mean that if you take the vectors with coordinate with integral coordinate and evaluate them against Q, then you obtain an integer. And okay, if this is not the case, if this is not the case, then you can just rescale Q. So integer. So it's not really a big condition, and so now I take an integer, and so one says that D is representable by Q and in Z to the n if there exists a vector, an integral coordinate vector, non-zero, such that Q, so which takes value D against Q. So here I require my vector to be non-zero. So if D is non-zero, this is immediate. But if D is zero, so what I ask is that I have a non-trivial vector which takes value zero against Q. So and so it this X is a representation of D by Q. And so the set of all such representation, I will note it. And okay, so the study of it of this set of integral vector is so one of the most venerable problem of number theory. So it has been studied for ages. And so the objective, so the goal is to obtain sufficient condition on D so that this set is non-empty. And then, so study the structure of that set of representation. In where? Oh, okay, the multiplicity is two. So, oh, yeah, sure. No. But that's a set of vectors. And So it's. So that's really a general question. But here, so then you look in. At least you can give, to start to investigate this question, you have some partial criterion. So you have the so-called ASA principle. Which is... which is, in that case, it's ASA Minkowski. And if you look at a representation in the bigger set, so you look at the representation, so the notation is obvious, so you look at the vector with rational coordinates which takes value d against q. So this set is non-empty, and this is a necessary and sufficient condition for the non-emptiness of that larger set, if and only if d is representable by q over the real numbers, and so for every prime, D is representable by Q in over the p-adic numbers. Okay, so this is a criterion which seems to involve checking an infinite number of conditions, but in fact this is really a practical criterion. Determining whether this set is empty or not is just a matter of checking the signature of the quadratic form, and for this. You need, in fact, only to check that this set is not empty for finitely many prime numbers. So there is a little difficulty when the criterion is valid, but if you want to check it, there is a little difficulty when n is equals to 2, and to have really a finite criterion, you have to use Gauss quadratic reciprocity law. So in Veris, n is greater than 3, but even for 2. So it's a practical criterion. And so when you have this ASA principle, now you want to look not at vector with rational coordinates, but to vector with integral coordinates. And then you could try to formulate an integral as a principle. So which would be, so that the set of representation with integral coordinates is non-empty. So if and only if, so so whether if you can represent D over the real numbers and for any prime so and whether for any prime P you can solve the quadratic equation so Q of x equal d when x is a vector with integral p-adic coordinates. So I should say that okay. So this integral as a principle is of course is something very natural to imagine, but it's so. So this principle is false, and so and it fails nearly completely. So and fails almost always. When n equals to 2, but so that case, so the failure is very well understood. It's so the fact that on the one hand there are very few, in a suitable sense, there are very few integral representation, and on the other hand, it's the fact that quadratic orders in quadratic fields in general have a large class number. Okay, so almost always I will not quantify. So, but so starting with n equal 3 becomes, I would say, more and more correct. So, and I will give a statement. Okay, what is the statement? Or maybe, yeah, I can give. Okay, here is a statement. Here is a sort of general theorem. So we assume that n is greater than 3. So we are in this situation. So there exists. Okay. Maybe I should. Okay. So. So there exists an integer d, which. Okay. N greater than 3, V greater than 1, some number. So there exists D, say D note, well, D note of Q and V, such that any integer greater than d note satisfies the integral as a principle if so, and then we have some conditions. So if. So. So, assuming n is 3 or 4, let's say the valuation of d at any prime p for which q, the quadratic form is anisotropic over is anisotropic over is bounded by V, and for if so you have so when n is relatively small, 3 or 4, you have to impose this condition, a bound on the valuation of d. And for you have an extra condition for n equal 3. Free. So n d does not belong to a disjoint set of square classes. So if n is greater is 5 or more, then there are no such conditions. So if n is 4, you have one. So if n is greater than 5, all what you request is that the discriminant is sufficiently large. If n is 3 or 4, then you require that the valuation at the anisotropic primes for q are for d are bounded, and you have and when you are in so for ternary quadratic form, you need to exclude these finite number of exceptional square classes. So it's possible that this set is empty. So, and in many occasions it's really empty. But here is one general statement that you can have. So you see that in a sense, integral as a principle is true for sufficiently large integers. More or less modulo possible additional condition. When I say satisfies the integral as a principle, I mean d is such that if this condition is satisfied, then there will be an integral representation. So.
Understand, but you said for n d larger than d zero.
Sorry. Excuse me. Yeah. No, it's accumulation of several results, and so it's plausible that you can make something sharper or more precise. But so and so the main so and in this theorem, so the the hardest case is the case n equals 3, which is basically due to Duke and Schultz-Pillow. So the n equals 4 case, I'm happy to attribute it to Clusterman. Also, just for so people in quadratic form, or I recall you that when n is greater than 5, there are no anisotropic primes, so that's why you don't have this condition in higher rank. Okay, but so the idea is that the theorem is the most difficult case is just at the moment where the integral as a principle starts to be significantly true, which is in the ternary case, and this is Duke Schultz-Pillow theorem. Okay. So I will continue with sort of general treatment. So for n of any size greater than 3, and so in the next lectures I will specialize to n equal 3, in which the analytic theory of GL2 automorphic forms enter. Okay, so when dealing with this problem, it's useful to generalize it a little bit. So if you ask this question about having a representation vector representing D with integral coordinates, so what you do is that you consider a family of n independent linear forms, and what you ask is that your vector takes integral values at these linear forms. So it's not necessary to take just the linear form which are the coordinates in the canonical basis. You could take any family of independent linear forms and require that your integer, vector be integral at these things, and this leads to the following generalization. So you consider L a lattice in Q to the n, so I call you finitely generated Z module of maximal rank. And so you can just ask exactly the same question. You can look at the representation of D by Q, but you look for the vector which are contained in this lattice.
How does it differ by changing the form itself?
Yeah, exactly. So it amounts to change the form. So if you want to change the form, then you go into the classical treatment of Ziegel. But so when you want to do things adelically, it's better to change the lattice. So that's And so then you formulate the integral as a principle for this, which would be where now LP is defined to be the closure of L in QP to the n for the p-adic topology. So LP is a the zp lattice in qp to the n, that is a finitely generated zp module of maximal rank. And okay, so you have this question. So as Hendrik said, if you just take another lattice, what you do is that if you that make a linear change of coordinates, you are just studying this problem over z to the n, but for a different quadratic form. But I prefer to fix the quadratic form. So it's okay. So okay, this condition, so this right hand side of this equivalence or of this alleged equivalence, I will say that D is locally representable by a Q in L. Okay. So the reason why one can prove this theorem or solve this theorem via say analytic method is that this problem, so the whether the integral as a principle holds, so has lots of symmetries, and I just want to spell out some symmetry. So here I will put G to be the special orthogonal group of my quadratic form. So the fact that my quadratic form is fixed means that this group will be fixed, and it will not change through the whole treatment. And okay, so then you let me call G of L defined it to be the stabilizer of the lattice L in this orthogonal group. So it's G in GQ times G of L is L setwise. Okay, so there is something obvious. It's that G of L acts on the set of representations because if you take a representation and you apply an element of that group to it, you will get a new vector which will have the same length for the quadratic form and which will also be contained in L. So that's one symmetry which is pretty obvious.
Can you give an example when the form is some sort of square, so what is G generated?
If L is z to the n, then g of say z to the n is SOQ of z, which is a group of orthogonal matrices with rational entries, and with n is free and q is the sum of free square, it's a very small, finite group.
Okay.
It could be infinite too, if the form is indefinite. Is it, I don't remember which. Is it S-free or more or less S-free? Yeah, yeah, S-free and sign changes. And you have to have positive determinant, determinant one too. So we're almost nearly S-free. And okay, and you have other kind of symmetries. So it's okay, interesting to consider. So now if you take so a rational orthogonal matrix, then an obvious thing also is that if you look at the set of so if you act on the set of representation of D by Q in L and you apply G, then it will be exactly the set of representation of D by Q, but in the in a new lattice, in the lattice GL. So here, so L and GL are said to be isometric, Q isometric. Okay, let me call it L Q G L. And so then you see, just by this equality, that the question of determining whether this set is non-empty is equivalent to the question of determining whether this set with another lattice is non-empty, not necessarily the same one. Okay, so it's good to be able to change lattice. So here we change lattice in one of the most obvious way. It's just that we transform it by an isometry and we get an equivalent set of representations. So these are really trivial symmetries. And also now the, the right-hand side of the, so that's for the symmetries on the left-hand side of the integral as a principle. And on the right-hand side, you have a bunch of other symmetries. So, which is equally obvious. So for any prime P, if you take a p-adic matrix, which is an orthogonal matrix, so which preserves a quadratic form, but over QP to the end, then you have that GP of R Q D of LP is RQ of D of GP LP. So again, the question of determining whether this set is non-empty is equivalent to determining whether this set is non-empty. And here, this is a different different p-adic lattice. And so then we make the following definition. So suppose that you have L and L prime, so two lattices in, so this is the set of lattices in okay, so we say that L and L prime are Q isometric at P if L prime is in the orbit of L under the action of this group, so which is exactly L prime is of the shape GP of L phi, if so, and we say we write it L L prime Q, let's say P. So at least if they are Q isometric at some prime P, then one of the conditions at the prime are equivalent. And if L and L prime are so Q isometric at every P, we say that L and L prime are say locally isometric. Okay, which we write L L prime Q lock. So we just ask this condition for every prime. And in fact, this condition, which seems to involve infinitely many isometries, in fact involve only finitely many primes, because, okay, remark. So L P equal L prime P equal ZP to the N for almost every P. So saying that two lattices are locally isometric means that they are P isometric for, so you need to check only finitely many P's. Okay. So we have this sort of definition, and what is just obvious is that the right hand side of the integral as a principle depends only of the local isometric class of a lattice and not of so. Another obvious thing is that if two lattices are Q isometric over the rationals, then automatically they are locally isometric. So a local isometric class contains a number of rational, global rational isometric class, Q isometric. Maybe I will also say globally Q isometric. Okay. What I should try to do is, good, with symmetries. Okay, so now I will so come to introduce the Hadels, and here I will introduce them to what is called the local global principle for lattices. So what is it? So you see, it was there, but so the integral as a principle, you when you consider it for general lattice, so you it involves the following: you have your lattice, and you associate to it this sequence of lattices in QP to the N, so just by taking the closure for the p-adic topology. So it's an element, so let me call it L hat, to be just this sequence of lattices, so which is an element of the product over all primes of p-adic lattices. So you have this map, and so the question is, so you have this map global lattice, and you associate to it a bunch of local datas, which are these lattices over the p-adix. And the question is whether, if you are given these local datas, you can reconstruct the global lattice. No, no, because I take rational objects. So and in fact, the answer is yes. You can recover, so which is this local principle. So the proposition is the following. So, okay, the map L gives L hat is bijective. So between between the set of lattices and so a subset of the full product so which is just the image of that map. So and here I put a prime and the definition is a set of sequence of lattices LP and what I ask is that LP is just the square lattice ZP to the end for almost every prime P, which means for all but finitely many primes. And and the converse of that map, so the converse map is given by this. So you have a sequence of local lattices, almost all of which are square lattices, and then you take just the intersection over all primes of Q to the n intersected with LP. So here it's a small abuse of notation. I see Q to the n as embedded in QP to the n, and then I take the intersection with LP, so then I have an element of a subset of Q to the n. I intersect all these subsets in Q to the n. And so that's the converse of that map. And so the proof is a consequence of the Chinese reminder theorem. Okay, just for the record, so because it was, I raised this remark here. So just to see just to see at least that you have to land in that space. Simply you remark that if L is any lattice, so I would just do the easy thing. So the rest is not very hard, but no time. But so if you take a general lattice, then there exists an integer depending on L such that so L is contained in 1 over n z to the n. So just take a basis of L and chase denominators. And then LP is ZP for all if P does not divide this integer. So that the image of that map is contained here is just this simple argument. And, okay.
How many guys are on the this intersection?
You mean how many? Yeah,
something injected, right?
Sorry, what is not in? No, no, it's bijective map.
But not one to one.
This map is one to one between this set and that restricted product. So just you take sequences of lattices, almost all of which are the square lattice, the square p-adic lattice. Then if you do this construction, so then you have a one to one map. It's not one to one if you take the full product. Because you can have lattices degenerating badly at sequence of. So it's a. Okay. Where I was. Okay. So. So now I can. So this local global principle is very important one because, okay, what do you have on the space of lattices? So because it gives you another description of a very natural set. So of course, you have, this space of lattices, you know, it's an homogeneous space under the action of the rational matrices, and it acts transitively, and that's an obvious action, but because of this description, you get new families of action, so which are less obvious, which are, you have an action of the linear group of p-adic matrices acting on a global lattice. Why? Because take GP in GLN of QP, and then you take a lattice L, and then you will define GPL to be, say, the inverse image of the following family of lattices. So let L, so I take minus one, and I take L prime P prime over P prime with L prime P prime equals, so GP LP if P prime is P, and equals LP if P prime is different from P. So you have a lattice which gives you a collection of local lattices. You modify one local lattice at some place P by the action of GP. So then you get a collection of local lattices, almost all of which are still equal to the square lattice. And then you go back and you get a new rational lattice. So you have, for every prime P, you have this p-adic action, which, of course, you cannot see if you just have the rational realization. And so then you can group together all these actions because they commute, obviously, because they act on different components or local elements. So then you have an action of a bigger group. So, and this bigger group is called the group of finite adelic points of the general linear group, which is this restricted product. So, which is defined as simply the set of sequences. And what do I ask? I ask that GP be contained in the stabilizer of the square lattice. So, for almost every P. So I take the sequence of p-adic matrices and invertible matrices, almost all of which are integral coordinates. So why do I need them? And the action, so this group acts on L Q to the N by the following map. So you have, say, G, so let's say JF is the sequence of JP. And then you say that JF of a lattice L, you define it simply to be the inverse image of the sequence of JP LP. So, and it will be some new lattice. And so what is happening is that I modify every local component, but since almost all these local components are the square lattice and almost all these matrices are stabilizing the square lattice, I change only finitely many components. Okay, and so this thing is a group of a finite adelic points of GLN. Okay, so one remark is that, so there is this natural action, and also you have, of course, the natural action of the rational elements. So in fact, these two actions are compatible. So the natural action of GLN is given through the GLNF action via the diagonal embedding . So simply, you take a rational matrix GQ in GLNQ, and you map it to the constant sequence of GQ over all prime. And here, this is just by looking at denominator, this belongs to that group of adelic points. And if you look at this action as defined this way, you obtain exactly the natural action. So when you see GLN of Q as a subgroup of GLN AF embedded diagonally, you recover the natural action. Okay. So we have introduced the notion of local isometric class among lattices, and then you can see it's easy to see that. So now, given L, any lattice, so it's okay, so it's global, Q isometric class. So is just the orbit, is the orbit GQ L. Okay, so that's obvious. And it's local Q isometric class. Is precisely G of AF of L. So where G of AF is an obvious subgroup of GLN AF. That is, you take the sequence of matrices which are all contained in the orthogonal group and almost all of which stabilize the square lattice. So then you see that the local Q isometric class is realized as an orbit of some very big group, And so GAF of L classically is also called the Q genus of L. So again, it's a subset of the set of rational lattices. And okay. And so now I will just I finish, but I will state maybe this proposition, which follows from all these definitions and the Assam-Minkowski theorem. So D is locally representable by Q in L, which means that D satisfies the right hand side of the integral as a principle, if and only if. Okay, if and I will write it that way, RQ of D of gen Q of L is non-empty, which means that if and only if there exists a lattice, a true rational lattice in the genus, in the Q genus of L, such that RQ D of L prime is non-empty. So what this proposition says is that, okay, if you satisfy the natural local condition for the integral as a principle, maybe you are not representable by a vector which is contained in your original lattice L, but at least you are representable by some vector contained in an other lattice which is locally isometric to the original one. And because it's very simple, I will just do the proof. And I will finish there. And so next time I will explain the general strategy to prove the Duke's theorem, or to prove the general theorem. Okay, so what you know is that D is locally representable. So that one direction is obvious. So the less obvious direction is if D is locally representable, then there is a representation by some lattice, in some lattice. So D is locally representable. In particular, D satisfies the Asse principle. So there exists x some vector, rational vector, so in Qn, such that Q of xq is D. Okay, so one thing that just chasing denominators, but what you know is that xq belongs to your original lattice for almost every P. So just because you clear the, so almost all denominators, you remove them and you will be have integral coordinates in the basis of L. So that's one thing. And okay, so for the remaining, and of course, if you were contained in LP for every P, then XQ would be contained in L, and you would have your the representation you are looking for. But so for the remaining primes P, then you know that there exists XP in LP, such that so Q of XP is D, just by because you are locally representable in L. And now you can invoke Witt theorem. So there exists GP in G of QP such that GP of XP is XQ, because you have two vectors which have the same length again this quadratic form. So the orthogonal groups over a field acts transitively over the vector of same length. So, and then you see that, so I finish here. Then you see that XQ, so then you see that for all P, XQ belongs to the lattice L prime P, where L prime P is either LP or L prime P is the GP LP, depending on the case. Okay, so which means that XQ belongs to this lattice L prime, whose local components are here, and this L prime, it's a lattice which is transformed by an isometry at finitely many places, so it's contained in the genus. Okay, so that's proof. So we have, we don't have necessarily the integral representation we want, but we have one for a lattice which is very close. So in a sense, the obstruction to the integral as a principle is given by this set of lattices in the genus. And in fact, so next time we'll see that the number of obstruction really is finite, and then we will see how to deal with this problem. Okay, thank you. Questions, comments?
Well, first, let me say that you succeeded to lose me.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Okay. Nevertheless, I do ask something. These massive constructions, the length of lattices, exposed to it.
Yeah, there are not many references.
Form is just some kind of a metric in the right? You are talking about the length of the vector because the precipitation, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, and the construction is really relative to the original quadratic form.
Yes.
So what happens if forms are rationally equivalent?
Oh, so then it means that you consider a different lattice. But not necessarily.
And the genus, classically, of the forms. And then you really go into some roundabout for me where to the Q genus of hell. So I would somehow naively expect that the construction of the.
No, so there is nothing new. So there is a bijective between the Q genus of L and what you could call the genus of Q, which. I don't know, the Ziegel genus of the quadratic form. So, these are basically the same. So it's just presented in terms of lattices instead of in terms of quadratic form. So, yeah. Okay.
It's for younger generation people.
No, I don't think so. No, it's just set theory here. Anybody lost? Yes?
In original Hassel-Minkowski principle, we see that we localize key at all finite primes and as well as infinity. But why do we take only finite adults here? Why not the full adult? I mean, also include the infinite part.
Oh, but so if you take a lattice and you take the closure of a lattice in Rn, you will get just the same lattice. So it won't change anything, in a sense. So. So you don't bring a new. So in fact, you don't need more information at infinity than the signature of the form. But you need it. But you need it for the to have the. So you use the Archimedean information when you use the Hassel-Minkowski theorem. So because you need something at infinity to the Asiminkowski theorem provides you at least one rational representation, which so then you use the Archimedean place there. But when it comes to integrality, you don't need to have more Archimedean information because integrality is about the finite place.
If we don't work in Q but in a number field.
Oh yeah, okay. It's the same. It's the same. Yeah. If you do a number field, you avoid. So of course you keep the condition at the infinite place to be representable in the vector in the full vector space, and then you take the local lattices at the finite ones.
Okay. No more questions. Thanks again.